Gabriel of Urantia is a spiritual leader, musician, author, visionary, and co-founder of Global Community Communications Alliance, a multifaceted world spiritual community and eco-village. Conversations with activists to inspire global change provides a forum for activists to voice their concern for humanitarian issues.
When I speak of the two-hearted people, or when I speak of the white man who think he's the boss of all the other races, I specifically mean the military-industrial complex.
Nancy Redstar is a citizen of the Abenakan Nation. She lectures and leads workshops throughout the United States on the teachings of the Star Ancestors.
That's a brotherhood, okay? And if you're talking about England, or you're talking about France, or you're talking about the United States, the Freemasons, the Illuminati, this is a brotherhood.
We are happy to have Nancy Redstar here. She's of Cherokee origin and of the Van family and of the Abenaki Nation. She has written many books in relationship to the Star Ancestors. She has interviewed healers and shamans from all over the world. And I've read three of her books so far, the Star Ancestors Trilogy. And I'm going to let her now share a little bit about her books.
Thank you very much for inviting me to speak here. And of course, the first Star Ancestors is called Star Ancestors, and then Legends of the Star Ancestors. And of course, the one you're in is called Return of the Star Ancestors. And then during the course of Legends of the Star Ancestors, I interviewed a gentleman who was in the National Reconnaissance Office. And I ended up doing a book with him called Life with the Cosmos Clearance. He was a member of the Disclosure Project in Washington, D.C., where 100 men broke their oath of secrecy together at the National Press Club and before Congress and the Pentagon. And I just finished a book where I went back in and re-interviewed some of these gentlemen, and that's called UFOs, No Threat, Official Eyewitness Testimony.
Now, a lot of people would think that certain governments are benevolent and always act for the people, and they don't want to believe that there would be any secrecy involved, and misrepresentation, or even believing that there's other beings out there, inhabited worlds that are already out there that are visiting. What would you like to share along those lines?
Well, the powers that be aren't that deep. I think that they go as deep as their pockets. And the real reason why they are not allowing this information out is purely economic. Because the zero gravity technology of the electromagnetic propulsion systems is a source of free energy, which would render the fossil fuel industry obsolete. They're not as concerned with social impact. They're concerned with economic impact. They don't really care about upgrading humanity or the evolution of humanity. It's purely for the dollar.
Some of the events that's happening now in the world, because it's purely for the dollar, a lot of Americans, again, don't like to believe that knowledge, truth is being suppressed. What are some of the important truths that you feel the American public needs to know?
Well, that one, that we have had free energy systems since the Third Reich, that Hitler was the first, and Germany was the first country to develop it. They were, obviously we know that Germany has the best science at that time, much more so than anywhere else. We didn't have it. We were advanced in the field of particleization because of Tesla, but we really were not building electromagnetic craft. And they had recovered some from the jungles, indigenous people brought out from the caverns in Brazil, and Germany bought them from the Brazilian government and reproduced them, back engineered them. The fossil fuel industry is one of the most destructive, the explosion, the whole industry based on explosion of the internal combustion engine is a destructive mechanism. Implosion, which is what is involved in centrifugal and centripetal force, is an implosive energy which was really found first by Victor Schauberger when he watched water and the vortex of water. And as he saw the spinning of the vortex of the water, he saw an energy that came out of a vortices. And it's that same energy that is used by the extraterrestrial craft. And so they have that spinning on the outside, but they also have it spinning on the inside. In terms of nuclear arms and atomic weapons, the reason the extraterrestrials sent representatives to meet with President Eisenhower at Murdoch Air Force Base in the Mojave Desert, they were bringing a warning of the nature of nuclear energy because, of course, the bomb had already gone off at that time. And that was after Roswell. I can't say it is anything other than a bold-faced lie that the extraterrestrials were in any way involved in some kind of trade where they were allowed to abduct people and they traded technology with our government. They don't do things like that. They come with a message, and it's a message. They don't need to trade anything because they are warning us. They're already equipped to deal with this kind of energy. But it's the toys that are being used by the weapons builders and the military-industrial complex that is ruining this planet. And so they came and gave warning, and that was it. They don't need to abduct people. They don't need to mutilate cattle. This is our own government involved in this kind of implant technology and subliminal scripting through elf wave patents and satellites.
Indigenous peoples from all over the world have had an understanding of their ancestors coming from the stars. It seems to have gotten lost even among many of the Native Americans today. Do you feel that somehow this can be rebrought to the Native American people and that new revelation can be introduced to them?
I don't think they've forgotten at all where they're from, but those type of information has been withheld in secret in some of their meetings. And it's just something that they've saved for themselves because they have lost everything else. And so they've saved that for their children. And with certain places, you will find that they know it, but they will not speak about it. But there are those that have no recollection. But in practice, there are quite a few that have active knowledge of it, but they might not tell you. They're forbidden to talk about it until certain signs have come, and then they release it like the Mayan calendar. You know, there's 20 to 36 Mayan calendars. The 26,000 year cycle is only one calendar. Out of those 20, there's five that are too sacred to be spoken of at this time. So the revelation of it all comes from the signs. If certain signs come, well, then that prophecy may be revealed as to whether it will be fulfilled or unfulfilled.
Some of those signs obviously are happening today. The Hopis do believe that we are living in now the beginning of the purification. Do you feel that that's true?
The Hopi say that we are in 2/3 of the way through the Third Great Shaking, which is World War III, which started in 2000. Within that prophecy, which, of course, there's 200, as I know of, I know there are 200 Hopi prophecies. We are in the purification. Yes, it's not reversible, according to the elders that I have heard from. It can't be changed back. But what they talk about is building the next world, the fifth world. And their song is that we will be dancing into the fifth world. That's how we're supposed to go in. Of course, there's going to be a lot of very painful events, you know, the things that have been prophesied, earthquakes and tornadoes and starvation and war, and a war like we have never seen before because of the technology. But they also say that the purifier that will return is the one with the high, high, high technology. And that when the fifth world comes, there will be a new frequency here that has never been on this planet before. In the Hopi prophecy, when they talk about the one-hearted path and the two-hearted path, that is a path for all colors. It doesn't matter if you're red, yellow, black, or white. The choice is to follow a spiritual path or to follow a material, greedy path. And that walk is what determines where you end up. And so, regardless of what color you are, if you take that path and you make that commitment to walk that spiritual path, then you're denouncing the third dimensional, reality, and you are giving up those needs for the material benefits and the weapons and that whole path where your head is severed from your heart. And I don't think it's about red, white, yellow, blue, black, because it's really about the heart. No matter what your color is on the outside, we are all related. And the Shoshone are calling now for all nations, all colors, all traditions to come together to pray for Mother Earth. And I think that is the essence of the teaching, the teaching for the planet.
That's very beautifully put.
Thank you.
I guess have quite a connection to Native Americans myself because of some of the past lives that I've had. And because they have been so oppressed for the last 300 years in America by the greedy, the worst of the white leaders, and they have been suppressed to the point of suicide, tremendous disease in their diabetes, and that continues to take many Native Americans because of improper food and government handouts that aren't the best foods for them. Lack of education. I know this is in other cultures too, but living here in Turtle Island in North America, it would seem that they, more than any other race right now, would be the ones, because of their suffering, to embrace a new light, to embrace a way out. And I sincerely believe that the fifth epoch of revelation is the way out for them.
You know, when the Tibetans went to the Hopis and they brought their tablets, and the Hopi brought their tablets out, the Tibetans said that the Dharma of the land will return to the red man. And it's all about the red man taking care of himself and learning, not speaking for all Indian people, which I wouldn't do, but I kind of wanted to read something. The Tibetans are a necessary link in ensuring the development of humankind's spiritual nature. The Hopi prophecy talks about the red hat, red cloak people who come from the East to North America to bring wisdom and knowledge. The people are encouraged to accept and understand these teachings and to put them next to their own. The prophecy warns that if these teachings are not used to guide the people back to the spiritual path, then the red hat, red cloak people will come from the West. They would come in large numbers and they would fall out of the sky and overtake the land in one day, just like red ants. They would have no mercy for anyone. The Hopi are instructed to hide if this comes to pass. As we align with the cosmic laws, we awaken to the unifying theme of our own evolution with one voice, a procession of faith, fires to light the way for the Creator. All the colors hold knowledge. Now, in a good way, we must share the teaching, for only if we do, we will be able to accept colors from other realms. I think that we have to do this together. I'm sure a lot of Indian people don't want non-Indian people doing it for him. We have to do it as equals, you know, holding hands as equal people. There's no boss over anyone. You know, one of my friends, he said, you know, the only problem with the way the white race has been since they came to America is they think they're the boss of all the colors. And Indians are very, very capable of surviving, you know, even though there's struggles and problems. I've seen Wall Street stockbrokers on Metro North trains with as much problem as an American Indian in terms of their alcohols and their problems in their mind. I don't think it's about being really about anyone leading one race out of an emergence from one world to another, that people have to come together and together lead themselves out. That everybody has something to share about surviving, what we need to survive. There's ways of surviving that only Indian people know about that will assist.
Well, you did say earlier that you thought that the Nazis and the Japanese actually may have went to the moon in the 30s.
Mm-hmm.
And can you share where that information came from?
It came from, it came through the French underground and then through MI5 and MI6 through to the OSS. And it was in raw footage with a handheld camera that was taken back in the 1930s. And I received it from Dan Salter, who had gotten it when he was in the National Reconnaissance Office. And it clearly shows, I published some of the pictures from that film, Adolf Hitler standing next to two prototype Honeyboos. That was the name of the craft. The Honeyboo 1 through 7, and then they had a RFC, which had laser weapons on it, on the underside.
So they did they use any of those laser weapons in the Second World War against the Allied forces?
No, they removed them they wanted to save them. They didn't want them to be gotten. Russia got in first and got a lot of the UFO technology and information, and then we got about 30 craft, according to Commander Graham Bethune. We pulled about 30 craft out of there, and of course all the scientists.
Hmm. And you said in your talk last night that certain reconnaissance UFO aircraft were shot down, and these were the three at Roswell. By what was the term you used?
It was at least 500 million megawatts of radiated energy was shot at those craft, you know, because they get their ability to travel off of the Earth's gravitational draw through electromagnetic waves, and so when they're going really slow, their stability is different than if they're higher up and moving faster. So they have to slow down if they're going to land, which they do. And I'm not saying that those were landing. They may have been coming in closer, and that's when they got them. and they were coming in slower. Oh, that project Paperclip, which a lot of people know about and have researched, that's Wernher von Braun was the rocket scientist. You know, he was the one that had gotten their first rockets to go off. And in that same project, as I was saying last night, he kept warning Carol Rosen, Dr. Carol Rosen, who was the head of Fairchild Industries. She was the first corporate manager of it, that she had to tell people the way it was coming down, that first it would be the Russians are our enemies, and then it would be the terrorists, and then it would be maybe an asteroid, and then the fourth, the last trump card would be the extraterrestrials, and that it was all a lie. And in fact, Star Wars was not against the Russian, it's being built against extraterrestrials. The problem is they can render all that equipment malfunction.
People that you interviewed from all over the world, shamans and healers from all over the world, have either seen actual UFOs or been visited themselves in some way, yet it still seems to be a taboo topic in television. There have been some films made, but most of the films that have been made, the extraterrestrials are bad guys and should be eliminated. So there obviously is a control of the media by the forces that you're talking about. Shouldn't Americans as a whole be hip to this fact that they still seem to be so naive of this? And
Well, you know, I think America's at the top of the pyramid, you know, traveling through space and in some, not only in the weapons building, but also in the knowledge, in this knowledge of this fact. Because going out there and meeting a lot of people, there's so many people that are waking up in a legitimate way. You know, it's not about abductions, okay? It's not about that. It's about the fact that they're doing the homework. They're putting the pieces together. They're doing the research. They're connecting the dots. And that takes a lot of work, okay? It's one thing to say you've been abducted. It takes no work whatsoever. But to do the research and find the truth, that is the key.
You know, we've been talking about the physical aspects of the Star Knowledge teachings. What would be your definition of the spiritual? Like, what is spirituality to you?
To walk for peace in the middle of abuse, to me, is probably one of the hardest paths to walk, because that is truly a spiritual path. To be able to be like Martin Luther King and see your relations being burned and, you know, murdered and hung and your friends murdered, and to be able to be a pacifist and still walk that path of peace. There's only two paths. And to me, the spiritual path is the path of peace.
So things are not going to be solved by who has the best weapons or the biggest sword. I know that in the I could agonize about those that were martyred for thousands of years, watching their loved ones also being martyred. And Jesus was the best example. He said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And how many of us could say that when we see our loved ones and ourselves being, you know, crucified? But that is the only way that we're going to walk the walk and of peace and walk in the truth of true spirituality.
I like what you say, because when you look at a revolution in a political sense, a revolution begins at one point and it's a circle and it ends up right where it began. But if you look at what you call a spiritual illusion or an evolution, you're not ending up at the same place.
Mm-hmm.
All of a sudden, you're opening up into a place that it's like the circle, and then the circle becomes a line, you know, becomes an emergence.
We do need a divine administration of really truly divine leaders, not gods, because we're only mortals, you know, but we have to walk in the truth of divinity. We have to be like God. And Jesus himself said that we can do greater things even than he, as we walk in the godliness that he wants us all to walk in as ascending sons and daughters of God. A lot of the people that you interviewed in your books, some of the great things that they said was along those lines of, this is where the correlation comes between continuing fifth and the Star Knowledge teachings, that when it comes down to is walking in the virtues of God, mm-hmm. in the heart, and the concern for each other, and the love for each other, and helping each other, and being thy brother's keeper. It sounds so easy and simplified, but yet it seems to be so difficult for people to understand, particularly in Western civilization, and I have to say America, mm-hmm. because America is so spoiled now.
Soft. Real soft.
If they didn't have the conveniences of life, they would die. You know.
Within your own community, if all the electricity went out, you would still survive because you've got your bikes without any cars running, without your telephones running. It would change your lifestyle, but you would survive because you're already set up that your world revolves around your garden, because that is your mainstay for your survival. And so everything would be based on your relationship and your communication with the activities around that.
With the earth.
But it wouldn't be that big a change for you because, you know, here and there people might be a little spoiled just by, like we all are, getting in a car. But I think it wouldn't be that hard for you to survive because you already are practicing for that.
Water. They're trying to take away our well water.
That you have?
Private, yes. Here in Arizona, a corporation, Salt River Project, they're trying to make claim to certain underground reservoirs, and they have already sent out letters of adjudication trying to take a lot of thousands upon thousands of people's private wells.
And what are people going to do?
Trying to be a pacifist now. I'll tell you what I would have done before I was a pacifist.
Yeah.
It's war. But now, boy, I tell you, it's prayer, a lot of prayer.
And are there legal?
Doing what we can legally to come against this. And, of course, we have our alternative newsletter in which we want to awaken people and so on, come together. But the things they're doing now is basically dictatorship.